You know, 90% of my time on social media is spent keeping my mouth shut. I mean, really, what can one reasonably say when one reads an exchange of tweets like this? Or a comment to a column I wrote like this? Or a Facebook post like this? This miserable fraud can easily multiply the number of examples, but we get the point. I'm sure that many of us here have been on the receiving end of negative or offensive comments online and on social media. Who among you have had that experience? Can we have a show of hands? Wow. Now, who among us here have been on the giving end of offensive comments? If you have ever trolled anyone, a rival, a colleague, an ex, please raise your hand. Thank you for your honesty. Politicians and celebrities have a much rougher time online and on social media. The abuse they receive is almost in direct proportion to their popularity. Of course, we suspect that much of this abuse is directed by rival politicians or done by fans of rival celebrities. But every day, even every hour, they receive abuse like this. Or this. Or this. Again, we can easily multiply the number of examples, but I think we can already begin to see a pattern here. First, the allegation of retarded mental growth, shown in the use of tard, as in noitard, dutertard, yellowtard. Second, the accusation of being paid, shown in the use of
bayad or its variations, as in akbayad or bayad muna or binay yaran.
You see, when we talk about what's online and social, when we say that talk online is cheap and coarse, this is what we mean. I forgot another example. The assertion that the person who takes a different stand or supports a different candidate must be stupid or ignorant, shown in the use of bobo, as in bobo tante. So when we say the talk is cheap and coarse, this is what we mean. When we lament the lack of civility in public discourse, this is what we mean. But wait, isn't all this opinion, and aren't we all entitled to our own opinions? Yes, and yes. But one thing I've learned as a journalist, there is more to free speech than freedom of expression. What these cutting comments have in common is a sense of offendedness. They are manifestations of wounded indignation. We feel offended that the MRT has stalled once again in the middle of the rush hour, and we direct our outrage at the yellowtards who don't even know how to run a train system. We feel offended at the latest news about more allegations or evidence of corruption, and we direct our outrage at the binayarans who see only conspiracy or politics in the allegations. Well, what's wrong with feeling offended when there is, in fact, something offensive? This is worth repeating and belaboring. If there is, in fact, something truly offensive, we should feel offended. But sometimes, the outrage can stem from something as simple as ordinary as peeled oranges. Make that pre-peeled oranges. A few days ago, the London-based advertising creative Natalie Gordon shared this photo with this caption, and Twitter erupted. Outrage responses like this were immediate. Then, just 3 hours later, Whole Foods, the supermarket chain, apologized for what it characterized as a mistake and pulled the oranges from the shelves. May I ask again for a show of hands? Who here think that Whole Foods did the right thing in pulling out the oranges? Thank you. Perhaps some of us here agree with the writer of this headline. How about that? The ultimate in bourgeois laziness. Or perhaps some of us recognize the self-referential sarcasm in the Atlantic magazine's slug for the Whole Foods story. Today in outrage. Think about that. Today in outrage. As though feeling offended at something is a daily trend. We see what you did there, Atlantic. Now here is something else that the Atlantic did. It gave this story this head and subhead treatment. Headline, and then read the subheadline. The outrage culture. Finally, some of you must be thinking, 6 minutes into a talk entitled How to Train Your Outrage, I finally get to the point. What is this outrage culture we are living in, and what do we do about it? The Urban Dictionary actually has a definition. The outrage culture is where people bend over backwards to be as offended as possible. Ryan Holiday of The Observer defines outrage culture by its product, outrage porn, and describes it by its characteristic, perpetual indignation. John Ronson wrote an entire book about the corollary, internet shaming, which targeted not only powerful institutions and public figures, but really anyone perceived to have done something, anything offensive. The outrage culture then is that state of constant offendedness, or at least a heightened sensitivity to taking offense, which results in what we can call virtual outrage. Outrage that is itself insensitive, one-dimensional, skin deep, and ultimately self-regarding. It is opinion not as ego, but as id. I want to make a distinction. Real outrage is one thing. The outrage culture based on virtual outrage is another. The first is necessary and vital to public discourse and the democratic project. The second is dangerous and quite possibly fatal to both discourse and democracy. Criticism should be encouraged, but criticism that dehumanizes its subjects, not so. I also want to make a clarification. Many other factors help explain the lack of civility in the online and social media space. Anonymity is convenient. Access is easy. The velocity of sharing is ever increasing. And cowardice, just like courage, is contagious. But to train our outrage so we don't aid and abet the outrage culture, let's focus on the role of opinion. What do we know about opinion? Here's a thought. Nothing in the universe is faster than the speed of opinion. Even before the light from the facts reaches us, we have already made up our mind. Opinion is instantaneous. Why? Because we already know what to think. As a newspaper editor phrased it, we have a media system with pre-existing views. Aside from the speed, we also recognize that opinion attracts similar opinion. It gathers the like-minded. And the more extreme the view, the more attractive it is to similar views. This leads to the phenomenon known as group polarization. In the age of greater connectedness, this is the paradox of our time. In the age of greater connectedness, we are more divided than ever. We also understand that opinion, though expressed only through words or images, can truly hurt us. Its impact is real, measurable in units of trauma or abuse. We also acknowledge that while we are all entitled to our opinion, not all opinions are equal. The democratic ideal welcomes all views. Sifting through the views to find the meritorious is a Republican responsibility. Last but not least, opinion can be reasonable. It can be worthy of our trust. It can help heal, build bridges, bring us together. Part of the method used by Aristotle with Plato, the world's history's greatest teacher and thinker, was his reliance on endoxa, what he called credible opinion or reputable opinion. And if it was good enough for Aristotle, it should be good enough for us. How then do we train our outrage? How do we keep it real? I would like to propose a 3-step training process, each one involving that hidden, unspoken virtue of doubt. When we encounter something offensive, a statement, an image, an idea, our first reaction must be to doubt everything. Our second must be to go to the opposite end and give the benefit of the doubt. Only then can we do the third and try to resolve all doubt. So first, doubt everything. When a controversy erupts, we do not rush to publish. Instead, we should first doubt the facts of the issue, doubt our grasp of the issue, doubt whether we even have anything to say about the issue. In a world of pre-existing views, hardened beliefs, absolutist thinking, and polarized opinion, what we need are fewer certainties and more doubt. Doubt is good. It forces us to investigate the experience, to ask the necessary questions. Pardon my French, but in the shitstorm Manny Pacquiao created with his unthinking, unchristian depiction of LGBTs as worse than animals, it was very difficult to find common ground between the defenders of Pacquiao and the critics of Pacquiao. But here is one valiant attempt. In this exchange over Pacquiao's lack of schooling, Inquirer.net reader Alex Alvarez dared to ask, does a man really need to go to school to educate himself? Now, this is a necessary testing of the assumptions of a given view or position. It undermines the prejudices of the educated critics of Pacquiao by probing their ready certainties. I should point out, however, that the exact reader's question can also be used to probe the position of Pacquiao's defenders as well. Second, train our outrage by giving it the benefit of the doubt. When a controversy erupts, we do not rush to judgment. Instead, we should seek first to understand the nuances, the details, the motives of the persons involved. That is how we can slow down the speed of opinion, by coursing it through the glass of reflection. For instance, in praising the singer Kitsy Nadal's criticism of Mayor Duterte's womanizing, Gab Valenciano also took Duterte to task for his casual statements about killing. At the same time, he said he wasn't going to vote at all. "My refusal to choose is my own personal protest." Now, whatever one may think about that position, it must inform one's reaction to Valenciano's original critique. This is what you call an attempt to engage with his position as fully as possible. And third, resolve all doubt. Only then, after subjecting the facts of the issue to searching doubt and understanding the nuances and the details, do we begin to search for certainties. And we do that through a process of truth testing or verification. As it happens, these three practices are the fruit of reflection on 2 decades of work as a journalist. They are a summary, my personal summing up, of what defines journalism. 3 things: independent-minded skepticism, public-spirited fairness, and a discipline of verification. Shall we walk through the 3 steps again, this time using journalists? To train our outrage over any issue, we should learn first to be skeptical. We should learn second to be fair, to be compassionate, to serve a higher interest. And we should learn third to test the truth. Remember our discussion on pre-peeled oranges? It was a very distant 6-7 minutes ago. Here is the original tweet. And now here are the tweets from those with a different view of the issue. Let's look at 3 examples. 1, 2, 3. Now, how many of us here still think that Whole Foods did right in pulling the oranges from the shelves? A show of hands, please. I'm imagining that some of you are hesitating. If there are more of us now who think, "Well, I don't know," then perhaps we might be getting somewhere. Please repeat after me. "I don't know." And that's all right with me. This is a good, thank you, you're a very good audience. This is a good, "I don't know," because it is based not on ignorance, but on a robust skepticism and a desire to find out more. And this is a good, "That's all right with me," because it's based not on indifference, but on a healthy regard for other persons in other situations. In closing, I am only a journalist. This is only my perspective. I hope it makes sense, but I will be the first to recognize that it has its limits. For instance, and this is a very big exception, these three steps do not apply to relationship dynamics. When your significant other invites you to watch Always Be My Maybe with her or him, for goodness sake, do not exercise skepticism. When your BFF says, never doubt my friendship, trust me always, well then, never doubt, always trust. And when a member of your team or a member of your family wants physical affirmation, do not quibble over whether to give a platonic hug or an actual Aristotelian embrace. But in the public square, in the online and social media space, these three practices may make a difference. They may teach us to spend more of our time holding our tongues until we are good and ready. The freedom to keep silent and the listening that makes possible are underappreciated aspects of free speech. And when we finally open our mouths, whether to speak truth to power or give voice to the voiceless, to unburden ourselves or simply to lighten the mood, these three practices may help turn our opinion into a force for good. Thank you.